probably take a Friday off too.
Oh, but then next week, like Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
Probably.
Friday. No, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday are free.
Maybe.
It's on the refrigerator. The big white one next to the front counter.
Yeah, it sounds good. Whatever. So it's gonna have to the 18th, I have to be here at 2 p.m. So you're working what? Probably working that Wednesday and Thursday, so it'd just be like a Tuesday. What time do you offer?
I get up Monday, I'll be working all night, but I'll be completely free Tuesday. Maybe it'd be better to just try to plan like a snowboarding trip. Because that'd be like just one day. It'd be a lot of fun, you know.
Sure.
Are you guys gonna be ready here to get started
and
in like
I wouldn't have to
3 minutes?
About, like overnight.
Is that reasonable?
Oh yeah, and I could always just, you know, go.
Because
I
don't know what
I'm gonna be doing that anyways,
doing,
so
we can just,
I mean, I'm trying to get my friend out, but
yeah.
He's been working weekends, so
I know. Maybe if you can just like keep me posted on when you're gonna
mostly gonna be around the weekends.
Okay.
If you wanna just go out on a Friday, I could do that too.
Do you guys all have Git environments set up already?
I have a command line Git.
That works. That's but that's we're not no graphics allowed today.
No graphics allowed.
Yeah, once you guys know what you're doing.
No Visual Cortex.
No. Banned. For today.
I can't wait to try to take my little car.
Susan, did you get one set up? Or can you download and install Git if you haven't already?
Oh.
Right, for your own sake.
Yeah.
It's all good.
Are you? But your car is better.
Yeah.
You have the
all-wheel drive.
You have a, what do you have?
RAV4.
RAV4. That's like, oh my gosh, that's a totally different tier than my fucking thing.
Your little, is yours front or rear-wheel drive?
I don't even know. Yo,
you saw them Versa?
Yeah, it's a Versa.
What year?
2009. I'm sorry, I called you Eric. You're Evan. What the fuck is wrong with me? I'm sorry, dude.
I go by whatever. It's
are
fine.
You,
I'm even I don't
like,
even know my own name.
Are you just going to be like, hey guys, Git-H.
That's it.
Here.
That's it. Class dismissed.
We're done here.
Yeah.
I'm gonna take like notes and everything about them. It's front or rear or left.
It's not exactly the same.
What's your major?
It was ECE.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm free.
How about this?
I'm liberated.
Yeah? Oh, you graduated already.
I did.
So I was like, either drop out into.
Drop out, yeah.
Well,
I mean, it'd be the
drop out into aerospace, you know?
Oh, that's.
That was an option.
Yeah.
Oh, man, I gotta finish this thing so we can get started.
Bad design.
Thanks.
Oh.
Yeah,
I guess
we'll use this shitty website.
Oh, the web design?
Yeah.
There's always some down here somewhere.
Yeah, oh, you thought I was attacking your.
Yeah, I thought you were like reacting.
Is it over here?
No.
Oh.
Look at this. Yeah, your front wheel drive.
Oh, this is the Git workshop.
Yeah.
Put on by Joe.
Why
at 1 o'clock.
Here? Did he not put my name on any of the emails?
We figured you're gone.
Well, I'm the one who's here and Joe isn't, so I don't know what that says.
That's hilarious.
Andrew's on Hangout if anyone is...
That's the one.
Why is Andrew not here?
I don't know.
Why am I the only person here?
Well, I've been using GitHub, but I just wanted
okay.
to... So.
Sorry.
I can assist with some things, I just want to fill out my knowledge.
That's good, I'm glad that...
And I think
I'm not entirely...
Mark's the same way, so...
Right, yes.
What am I getting, and how do I get it?
The frame is too
small. Is that a or is that like an actual question?
No. I sort of know too much.
Where'd Eric go?
Oh, you already have it right there.
How'd you mount this earlier? It fell off. How'd you mount it?
Just balanced it on the
you just balanced it.
Just had to probably get something better than that.
And this might, I don't know
what
this
is
used for.
Yeah, exactly.
This might be one of those situations where it is like less smooth the second time around.
No, this is for the people who aren't here or couldn't make it.
Oh, for making a recording.
Cool. Okay.
Hopefully we can edit out all the beat and stuff. Or you know, just fast forward work a bit of time or
something. Well, if we're all set, let's go to slide two. Slide one. Git workshop. Joe isn't here, but he might show up. I'm here. I should just delete his name forever for this. But that's fine. So you know who Joe and I are, and you also know what PSAS is if you're here, because we're in the PSAS room. So I'm going to breeze through that. So a little bit of background. What is Git? It's created by Linus Torvalds, who worked on the Linux kernel, or the inventor of the Linux kernel, in 2005 to manage the code base that they were developing. It's a distributed revision control system, which is different from a centralized revision control system, because basically it takes the entire repository and makes a local copy of it, so you can work on it offline and continue to update it, and then synchronize all the changes you made locally at once to the remote server. A centralized one, you'd always have to be online and uploading to. It's, you know, we have 4G connections and that sort of thing nowadays, so it's a little bit less relevant than it used to be, since you can even use your laptop on a plane, but it's still handy to be able to organize it in a distributed manner like that. It's relevant for things like GitHub, which hosts all these open source projects, including all of PSAS and Orisat's work and code and everything else. Right, and then on the bottom I listed a few other revision control systems that you might have heard of or might hear about at some point. Let me know if I'm in your way, I can move to the other. Oh, gotcha. Right, and then also Joe and I tried this, and some people use it and some people don't, but you can also go to that link, and even on your phone, and you can type in questions that'll like show up on my screen, and then they can be addressed at the appropriate time. It's kind of a handy little thing. And then you guys can also see each other's questions and like upload them. It's kind of a nifty little thing, but it's not super important. So this workshop, if you haven't used Bash, which is kind of one of the default shell environments in Linux, we'll kind of introduce that a little bit, because even the Windows version of Git uses a Bash shell to interact at the basic level by default. So you're going to know the first like five things about that, and then the first 20 things or so about Git, and then that's what we're going to be planning to cover. And then we'll talk about how to use it to collaborate. And it says we won't cover like how Git works and advanced features, but if it comes up, it's not like I'm going to purposely bypass it. Just yeah, and we're definitely not using the GUI today. That's a law
as part of this workshop. So you guys were all set up. Did you get set up with? That's okay. This is good, actually, because last time it took us like 25 minutes to get it ring set up.
Are we talking about this?
Yes, that's it.
Okay.
That's all we needed for.
Where is
it's also, if you haven't already, go on GitHub, everybody, and create an account there, just for fun. That's honestly, this is like the longest section. Run these as well, if this is your first time setting it up. Who's using Windows, by the way? One, two. A nifty thing I found out this last week or something. If you go on the Windows 10 like App Store, you can download. There's an app called Ubuntu, basically, but it gives you a full like command line Ubuntu environment. So you can use things like Git and other tools within Windows like semi-natively. It's really nice.
They actually have a fully native install. You can do. You have to go into your advanced features of your software and open some apps features and stuff like that. But
when you mean Ubuntu within Windows?
Yeah.
We might be talking about the same thing.
Yeah, maybe.
I don't know.
But you can install.
I don't know all the terminology behind it, but
yeah.
I mean.
Or at least the support for it is native now through that. So. All
right. It sounds like we're talking about the same.
Yeah,
thing.
It's just the difference is through the App Store or not.
Yeah. Okay. Fair. That was the easiest way I found to do it. It's like a one-click thing. And then you can also, I found you can run like graphical applications if you set up like an X server on your Windows side, it'll forward the window and open it there. It's not officially supported, but. Are we good on this? Anybody need a hand? Good.
So if you do git config list, yeah, you're just setting the user.email and user.name.
Right.
Okay.
And then, you probably want to make sure that the editor is set to nano instead of vim, but vim is good too.
Why nano over vim?
Because vim has all those keystrokes and stuff and people get confused by it.
Oh, okay.
But if you know what you're doing, you're good. And if you don't know what you're doing, I can help you out since we don't have a lot of people. We can come back to that at any moment. So there's two ways to create a repository. You can just create one using Git on your machine. And then you have to go back and tell Git to like connect to your remote server, which would be on GitHub or however it's hosted. I find it a little easier to do the reverse and create it on the server using GitHub or something like that, and then just clone it down. So when you clone a repository from a server, you're basically taking everything that's in there right now and copying it down. You're cloning it, so it's just an exact version on your computer as soon as you do that. So it would actually be a good idea to follow through with these steps and log into your GitHub and make a little sample repository that you can delete later or something like that, and then clone it down to your machine. And so go ahead and let me. What we also did, and we can test this out again because we're trialing this little feature, if you guys can log into the link and then let's see, what do we do? You need permission?
Yeah.
I see.
Oh, yeah, you have to try to get it. You have to part of that. PDFs.
Yes, but I can turn that off. All right, you should be good now.
Or else you already
So you're going to make a repository on GitHub, on your GitHub account.
So when you do git init in a repo, that repo is now stored on GitHub?
No. Git init means it's on your computer but not anywhere else. Does that make
sense? So,
can so you then you have to go back and tell it where to, what server, or set up what server you want it to use.
Okay.
But if you do git clone from the server, then it clones it and it already has that information in there as soon as you clone it. So it's kind of
how do you set up the information?
I think Joe put it in here. But I guess. I usually try and avoid doing that. And if you want to do it that way, that's fine as well. So if you go to that page, the link up there, there's a thing that says thumbs up when cloned. So if you guys just click like thumbs up on there as soon as you've cloned a repository to somewhere on your system, then I'll know that we're ready to move on. All right. It's fine. You know, it's fine.
So what for the URL?
Create all the specifications.
So you have
and that she'll add something on your
control shift. If you create a folder,
but you copy and then you'll see.
Just make a copy folder and then do git init.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just do your sure. Copy.
Usually it was version.
Okay. Then do
yeah.
Control Alt
and then.
You can definitely do definitely sucks.
I'll have to figure out how to do that better.
Should just look up like the Windows.
I don't know what the.
And then
would that be called like the Windows
client?
I'm trying to figure out how you can like keystroke paste stuff into a Windows bash.
Yeah.
And are you inside of the folders from your GitHub repository?
Oh, so I haven't control made it on my GitHub.
I've always ended up just deleting.
Yeah, that's the reason why.
I
want to initialize it in the bubble and then push it to my GitHub.
Try git status.
What do you just say? Do I need to go and actually add something here?
So right click on the title bar of your git or your bash.
Copy. Oh no, it's just for pasting this in there.
Yeah.
So I just did a click and paste instead of like I tried control
V. Oh, you can actually click and paste?
Yeah, that's what I had to do because I tried control V.
So now you started out so click on the corner.
You don't need the parents.
I don't.
Or hover over it. So I copy that.
And then there.
Yeah. But you have to remove that.
Oh, or you can just right click on your
get rid of the
git commit -m or -m. Then you can just add your comment in quotes after the dash out.
All right.
Instead of having to open text.
What?
So if you do, instead of just git commit, do git commit -m and then do a quote after that. So just like whatever your commit message is going to be.
Oh, word.
Yeah, it saves you having to open up the text.
That's great. Yeah, we don't,
And then normally, I pull before I push.
Oh, I'm.
But since you don't have that.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll try to push and see what happens. Using this, where I think the name might be the
file, and then the URL is the Git repository that you're pushing to.
Do you know what it's supposed to be? Wow.
Hey, Joe, how do you initialize a repository to like an
Git init.
Yeah, but then how do you tie it to the server?
Git remote set URL.
Okay,
that's right.
What do you want to set the URL to?
The same thing that it tells you to like copy paste when you want to.
Okay.
This is mkdr make directory.
Yes, that is right.
You have to have the repository already made for that to initialize it on your GitHub page, or will that initialize the repository on your GitHub page?
So Git init just makes like the local stuff. So it basically just makes the .git folder.
Mm-hmm.
To make a repository, that's a totally GitHub thing.
Okay.
So, like the usual way to do it, if you're starting from scratch and you know you want it to be on GitHub, would be to just create the repository on GitHub, mm-hmm. and then clone mm-hmm. the empty repository.
This should work.
That's better because you don't have to worry about fiddling with the URL and everything.
If you already had something that you were working on locally as a Git repository, and then you wanted to put it on GitHub, you'd create the repository on GitHub, and then merge that with your local thing, and then push it.
Hmm. Thank you, Joe.
So when you guys have a that Git bash open, you can see the little squiggly, the tilde or whatever. So that all that is shorthand for your home directory, which on Windows is going to be /users/edit, I think. So you basically just copied all those files into that directory. Let me find a whiteboard. Can we erase this?
That's just strength of materials stuff.
This is.
Oh, that's all statics. Yeah, you can erase that.
Except for the upper corner.
Oh, the right hand side. Oh.
That's a better one.
That must have been a weird Unicode thing or something, because it definitely said clone, and then I typed clone again. Someone using like a wireless mouse or something. That makes sense.
So I'm guessing we're just at the point where everyone's cloning a sample repository.
Mm-hmm. So I'm changing my profile picture.
So this is basically what this stands for, your home directory. And so you can also have like stuff that just looks like directory. But it doesn't, you can use CD and then type in whatever directory you want to go to change directories and navigate around in your folders. You do CD dot slash something to ./talks is your current directory. So if you do cd dot, then you're just going to go to the same place you're already in. cd./folder would put you into like the next subdirectory called folder, so on and so forth. cd.dot goes up the directory.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you do cd./something, it'll like go out and then it's like next door to you.
Right? Create a repository in a while.
Whatever you're in, so if you do a git clone of a repository, it creates a new, if you're in this directory and you do git clone, it creates a new folder with the name of your repository. And that's all the files inside here.
Wait, what? So if you're, it makes it a subdirectory of your current directory. The whole GitHub directory.
Right. So you can basically make a repository anywhere on your file system,
mm-hmm.
and it's just going to go right where you are with a new folder, nicely
mm-hmm.
packaged for you.
What's the move? It's like MV-R, right? And then your location, like object, subject.
I don't think you need the dash R play.
Yeah, if you do MV...
Dash R play for what?
For just
moving
files.
I don't think you need the dash R usually. You just do MV what you want and then where you want it.
What you want to move, where you want
to
move it.
Yeah. And if you're using a file, you will rename it to whatever this is.
Okay.
So like you can, it's basically also it's the same as renaming.
Yeah.
Or it's the same command,
right.
Whichever one you want to do. If that makes sense.
You don't have to do dash R. Even if it's like a file tree.
I don't think you have to.
Yeah.
If you try it and it doesn't work, it might be worth trying with a dash R, but I've never had to use it.
Okay. So. Also, I think most shells you don't need the ./ in front of.
Yes, correct. Correct. And also, so those are just some shell tips for people who are new to using the shell. So, stepping forward into usage now that we have a little workspace to experiment with, do you have like that test repository set up and stuff? Just because Joe had a couple samples that we can use to demonstrate some of these weird concepts that we might touch on. But these are the basics. We're not to that weird stuff yet. So we have cloning, which we just went over. Pull will look for updates of whatever repository you're in currently on your command line. So all you have to do is git pull, and git already knows which repository you're in and which one to pull. You don't have to like specify anything.
Doesn't it pull up the entire repository?
What do you mean?
Like, okay, when I'm in a really, really deep subdirectory for, like, alphas, and I do git pull, it does everything.
It does everything
in
the alphas repository.
Alphas.
So it'll look all the way back to the root, and yeah, it'll sync everything.
Mm-hmm.
Just a little unfortunate, but every now and then you have, like, 10 files that all have 50 versions of a SolidWorks folder, and you try to download like a 2 kilobyte file of code, and you have to download 10 bytes.
Mm-hmm.
I think you
stuff.
There's I'm pretty sure there's ways to grab only a couple.
I mean, you can download raw, but it doesn't really sync with Git. Like you have to.
Can you do a git fetch on a certain file if you only wanted? I haven't experimented with that, but I'm pretty sure there's a way where you don't have to. I wouldn't recommend it. That's usually.
Well, where you don't have to what?
But I can also see cases. Like
if you want to
grab one file off the server without doing the whole thing.
If you find out how to do that, I'd love to know.
Yeah. I mean,
maybe I'm mistaken.
It seems like it'd be a really handy thing to do.
Yeah.
We can look into that later. That is interesting.
Yeah, especially with like the mechanical reasons.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Because I've never had to do that. It's just code, so it's like takes 5 seconds. Download 10 versions of SolidWorks every time I want to see what's changed.
the mechanical repos are over a gig.
It's pretty small.
I had issues pushing from the virtual machine on my laptop because I allocated 10 gigabytes and nothing else on it. But in order to push to the repository, I needed to download the repository, and the repository pushed my memory past what it could handle.
Yeah, you could definitely use that one file trick if we can figure out how to work it.
Mm-hmm. Especially since all I was doing was literally text files.
Stepping forward, committing changes, so basically it takes you bring in the repository and you run a pull to make sure it's synced up as current as it can be, and then you make some changes, you do your work and whatever, and then committing basically says I've done some amount of useful stuff. You can kind of decide what that means to you, and we can go over that coming up here. And you're saying I want these to go out to my team members, like, you know, I'm kind of at a checkpoint. And then eventually those changes will be uploaded and synchronized to the rest of the team. And committing only works on your local repository. You have to push to put it up on the server. Because, like we talked about, it's a distributed RCS, so you can make a whole bunch of changes on your local machine and then sync all of them at once, and that's what push does.
I think the other slides have a little diagrams.
That's right. I don't need to go into too much detail quite yet. So here's the clone. So this is what we just did. And also, everyone created an example repository to clone, which is pretty straightforward, but if it's something that's been in progress for a while, I mean, you're always welcome to clone whatever PSS repo you want. And you should. It's going to copy the whole change history as well. So you're basically fully up to speed with what's been happening.
When you say the change history, do you mean, is there some file that says this is a list of all the changes that have been made? Or
yeah, basically that's
up to date.
That's what it is, but it doesn't matter that much to you because the git commands handle all of that for you. That exists somewhere. But like, yeah, don't worry about the file or anything. You just tell Git what to do, and it'll handle everything for you. But basically, yes, that does exist somewhere on your system.
Are we gonna get into how Git decides which revisions get to take priority?
A little bit, yes, we will.
Okay,
like branching. And then like
I don't entirely understand that. I'd like to.
It is some black magic at a certain level, but well, we're gonna touch on that. Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Did we do examples when we got to these slides? Or did we save space for that later? I think we just kind of did it as we were. We can do it.
Yeah.
So, have a turn.
So when you've got changes in your repo and you want to actually build a commit out of those, you can identify that with the git status command. So if you have repo changes, do git status, it'll give you a list of a bunch of files in probably red if you've got a terminal with sports colors. And it'll tell you, here are some files that have been modified, here are some that have been deleted, here are some that have been moved, depending on what you've done.
Mm.
And anything that's in red is just changes that you've made, but you haven't said you want to actually do anything with those changes yet.
Mm.
And to actually tell Git you want to do something with those changes, use the git add command. So usually you'll just do git add and then the names of those files.
But wouldn't you?
If you want to. If you've made changes in a lot of files and you want to just dump them all into your commit, you can do git add and the dash capital A flag. But that can be a little obnoxious if you're like accidentally adding temporary files. But we can get into that shenanigan later.
Why are you doing what you're doing?
So once you've added stuff to a commit, it's still not actually a commit yet, so you can kind of play around with what files go into the commit and which files are kind of ignored from the commit. once you actually are satisfied with the changes you've made and which changes you actually care about sending to other people, you use the git commit command. And if you just do it by itself, it'll bring up whatever your default text editor is. And if you haven't changed, it's probably Vim. And if you don't want it to be Vim, or you don't know what Vim is, you probably don't want it to be Vim.
I didn't mention that. It was on one of the slides.
Okay, good. You can also do the dash M flag to just manually give it the message for the commit. It's a little bit nicer to do it in text editor because there's this syntax where the first line is your short message, and then you skip a line, and then everything else goes into your long message.
Mm-hmm.
So like the short message gets displayed, you know, in GitHub where it's got the files and it's got little messages to the side,
mm-hmm.
kind of just describing what the last change on those files were. That's the short message. So if you've got really complicated changes or you want to like make notes about something that is still wrong with the changes you've made, or you know, anything miscellaneous that you can't describe in like one line, that goes in the long changes.
Where is the long change displayed on GitHub?
On GitHub, do you want me to plug in?
Maybe. Okay. Well, what I was going to do is just run show this off for people. So this is a repository I had set up for a school project a while ago. Pretty much everything's in this kl.py file. And these files here were never like uploaded, but I had them in my workspace. I just never committed them to GitHub. So basically, even though I can run commits, pushes, and pulls, like those files, Git is going to pretty much ignore them until I tell it to add them and their and the changes I've made. So let's just say I wanted to add kl-draft.py to my repository. It's just git add. Then kl-draft.py. So after I run my git status, then it's saying that we're going to add a file called kl-draft.py to my repository. Then it's going to ignore all these ones in red here, since I haven't added them yet. And then if I do, so to do a commit, the way I usually do it, and Joe was just talking about this, the dash M versus typing in a longer message. I usually do it with just dash M, but.
Would you mind showing real quick the, so I've had that before, you git commit and pull the text editor.
Mm-hmm.
I am unable to interact with it. I don't know how to use it. Could we just go through an example of that, just like a one line?
Pull up Vim or?
Yeah, I mean, it's not about, so if you,
oh, yeah.
So right now you're in command mode, if you hit I.
Oh, that's not Vim mode.
So
just type that one in. And
oh,
then
so I'm in
man mode. Yeah, you set it to new.
Oh,
yeah.
I see.
So now you shouldn't have any issues.
But then you like save and quit? Like
Control
that's
O?
What I'm more confused about. So like short
yeah,
message,
so you
long message.
Write it out.
Control O.
Which is, it just tells you down there.
Yeah, Control O write out
sequence.
Is like,
mm-hmm.
Okay,
and
but now?
Just hit it right. Now you hit the Control X. That's
Control
right.
X. And
okay.
Pull up that
that's
folder
fine.
In Explorer.
Okay.
Yeah, that's
file.
It.
Did
you
get somewhere
in there?
Just the reason.
Oh, you're on brand new.
Whatever.
Get that number.
Am I doing things right? Wrong? I don't know what I'm doing.
I just created a little text file in Vim. I might as well try to commit it.
Okay. So this is not the syntax you want. So do git status.
So you write out and then exit.
Okay, so right now, these are just changes that are hanging.
Oh, you had already
in the
yeah.
You need to stage them for commit. So if you do git add in the file name.
That's it.
Done?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, so top of them at readme.md.
So now if you do status, it will show up in green, telling you that this is part of the commit that you're putting together.
So I would just then do git commit. Oops.
Just, yeah, whatever.
What was the dash M?
Dash M lets you put your message in on the command line versus using a text editor.
So, no to that?
It's a matter of preference.
That's your stuff.
So, you've already told it which files you want to be in the commit.
Because
sometimes you'll end up with commits where you've got like
all the
files that you've changed. So that's kind of what I'm
going
to
do.
Oh, you don't have nano installed.
So what I need to do for the
commit.
Short
CD.
Just try typing nano.
And then SU.
Yeah, there's no nano.
So that's just auto filling out. It looked in your directory to set
this is not the command I have memorized. It's all the slides.
You're in your you're in Susan and then you're moving forward.
It just hit your global
editor. Right, but you need to have the you need to have the nano editor installed for that to work.
Because
all that's saying is that there's a command that's nano that brings up the text editor.
So then
git bash, git commit, and then you're going to commit the one line of text that you changed. And then do space R E.
Is that right? What it's having me do is it's install it.
Or
I mean, you can use any editor. One thing is. I mean, if you're comfortable using Vim, that's great. I would say use Vim. But it's like an extra learning curve. I don't already know
what. You know what?
Yeah.
I took that thing in the past. That's what we used. VI.
So if you can actually tell it to use Notepad, but I would suggest not doing that because of the way Notepad fucks with new lines.
Here's the reference.
Figured out where the long message ends up going, by the way.
Oh, on GitHub?
Yeah. Because you knew that, didn't you?
Well, I mean, it.
So
I think like the best way to view is just look at the commit history, right?
I haven't seen that.
Oh.
Yeah.
Where are you finding it then?
Here, so I added this new file. So we've got the Fibonacci sequence versus the naive Fibonacci sequence. And then we click on the short message, and then contains and said long one. And this is a new file, so I guess one parent. I don't know how to find the commit history if that's the case. Word. That's a good place to find it.
And then the little ellipsis lets you expand out the long messages.
Thanks.
One other nice way to view the history and messages of things,
mm-hmm.
rather than doing it on GitHub, is there's a program called GitK. It's not installed by default on like every
mm-hmm.
distribution, but
yeah.
you just type GitK in the repo,
mm-hmm.
and then it brings up the whole like branch structure.
Right. Hey Joe, when you get a chance, let me look at what I'm doing wrong here. I'm just trying to add.
So you can see, like the different structure of how things have been merged.
Mm-hmm.
The only obnoxious caveat to that is see, I'm ahead of this commit that's tagged
mm-hmm.
version 0.1. If I check out that commit, now I don't see any of the history
yeah.
after it. Because commits only point backwards in time.
Okay.
Because they're
that makes sense.
They're unable to point to things that happen
yeah,
after them.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Cool.
And GitK is just a bash keyword?
Yep. And you can you know, view long messages in that too.
So GitK, what would I, GitK, would there be anything I'd use with that keyword? We'll just do dot get or
show it in the directory.
That's
why it's because code editor is.
No, it's just a command by itself. It's not part of Git.
Okay.
The file on Notepad doesn't show the
changes.
Sweet. Wow. Awesome. That's great.
It
Thanks.
Tells you a lot of like neat information about stuff.
No, I'm not.
You wanted to talk about
Can you help me understand how the merge and branch system works? Maybe with pictures and colors?
Yes. That is the end of the workshop. I can give you some of that information now, too.
Well, I'll just step off and get a drink of water if we're going to talk about anything.
Okay.
Take what one now? I think how merges and branches work.
Yeah, I can use it.
Up there and say what you did, so just do something like added one line of text or something relatively descriptive. Did everyone else add and commit one thing or something for fun, I guess?
Did anyone not?
Some of these guys are already in this space.
Oh, did you figure out an editor that worked?
Well, I tried going through the steps they have here.
So one file changed, it added three lines.
So if you are...
and now you're ahead of the server by
commit, so you add more. It is a good idea to load
it. It looks at the server and sees how many people are changing. So
standard
if I'm on my laptop,
I
have 10 commits.
People get used to muscle memory for Vim.
Or I'd be a heavy by 10.
Let's use Vim key bindings for everything else.
You are ahead of the server by one.
It's a little bit of a
well, how can I use it then?
So what would merging look like in that case?
So yeah.
What do I need to do? It doesn't allow me to commit
yes,
it because I didn't have it.
Actually really
right?
smart at
I mean, one thing you could do is just install a different text editor to
get
it.
But there are occasionally conflicts that will go over
mm-hmm.
a couple of
I mean,
it doesn't allow me to do it. So, I mean, I have
to
take from like created using Vim in the bash already.
So, might as well do it.
I'm sure there's a way to do that.
That's all you have to pay.
Because, like, when it.
I'm just committing it to.
It'll just push
your remote to
see.
Yeah.
Possibly. When it asks you to create a commit message, it's opening some file that it doesn't want you to see, and then when you close it, it's like checking if you've changed that file and saying, okay, you have a valid commit message. I'm sure there's some way to say use this particular file as the commit message, but I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just git commit, right?
Yeah,
have to watch this git status to see if that's still a thing.
Anyways, yeah. Like,
so I just want this one here, this one, this one.
The
nano.
What's
that?
So, like, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, every now and then you do, like, the same thing. You are working.
So we have to git commit?
I'll be working Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and
I'd
like.
Well, so one thing you could do is use the dash M flag.
Okay.
So completely bypass using the manager. So if you do dash M,
I'm doing it on the screen right now.
That's some cool stuff.
So which days are we talking about?
The only day that seems to work is that Tuesday.
12th or?
Or the 19th.
Okay.
So
I do have the machine shop.
What's the machine shop?
Yeah, you see me working all night on Monday.
Huh?
So I'm basically able to do three.
This is the message.
Fridays and Mondays I can take off.
Basically,
Friday.
But make sure you put something. Always, whenever you're doing a commit message, it really should be descriptive. It's pretty important. Seems like it's less important at the time. But
I think there's a relevant XKCD.
I think my boss is leaving on the 20th, so I basically have the 20th through probably
the URL of XKCD comic in
the
message field.
Free.
Was that not in there?
Okay.
Git commit dash message.
Yeah, so just
quote.
I've been saying things since
this is a commit.
School doesn't start.
Quote.
Right. and
the 8th, then I also have the
update.
5, 6, 7, and those things free.
Okay.
Right, and now?
I mean, yeah.
Okay.
Maybe like get your
a little bit of time left on my
machine shop class is on the 19th.
That's pushing. So once you commit it,
on the 18th, the Monday.
Oh, Monday.
Did you see the
I think that
thing about like the history
I'm
where it's showing like, all the little
okay.
commits
and I'm
gonna
like try to get some people together and like, off the ground
stuff
out. Okay.
That'll be like okay.
Alright. I'm gonna be up to the woods after work on Friday, and probably not back until. Back
so,
Saturday.
Like, in the history, when you commit on your local machine, you're basically making a new little node
okay.
in this graph.
In the master branch, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
But you still need to tell the remote repository about it, which is what push is for.
We're gonna do that.
Yes.
And I've still this editor my language and email and everything. Don't you have to get a password in there? Doesn't matter.
I think the default setup for Git for Windows is to ask you for a text 2-factor authentication, right? That's the way they do
it. I don't use it on Windows.
have you tried to commit? Have you tried to push anything?
In
GitHub?
I was just going to try that if it wants to
do it.
Yeah, I couldn't get the 2FA to work.
So when I push something,
turned off
yeah,
my 2FA.
It will always ask for help.
And I noticed that anybody who has ever turned it on has also subsequently turned it off. You've either set it up or you've never set it up. And if you set it up, you've turned it off.
So when I did git push, it said username.
I've struggled with it, and then I'm like,
that's for my GitHub account.
I have it set up
so
for
no
signing
like
into the website, but I just use SSH
or password
for actually committing.
Because this is just you messing around with all the files on your computer. Basically, if someone has the password,
so one thing I don't know if Joe mentioned, but with
to access and
add and clone,
account,
you can use add to bundle your changes before you commit them. Which is kind of the
okay.
staging idea.
Oh.
That's how it's protected.
So you make changes to like
okay.
10 files,
you,
and
you put in your password.
You're kind of doing two things at once.
So
like five of the
yeah,
files were kind of for one
to the remote
feature, and five of them were for another. You can say git
add
for 5, and then commit that with a message saying, like, add the login feature, and then the other 5, you put it in a different commit and say, like, change menu background or something, depending on what you're working on. So it can be handy to organize things that way. You can do, like, you can commit all at once, and that's fine. It's just kind of nice to break it down and give your team nice, handy messages.
Yes, and then
go for it.
Nice,
very important.
The most important part of the senior workshop.
So I think I was just kind of a good person.
Oh, that you did. You already done that?
Well, because I accepted, I already committed one thing.
Oh, yeah. So you add commit gallery.
This is not what you want to do.
At least those aren't your messages.
Right. Ideally, they would be more descriptive than some of these.
I mean, the first one is, obviously.
Yeah. The first two are except.
Do we have mouse over text?
Merge. Merge branch is AFDFSF. AFDFDF. Yeah.
Nice.
So, hey, Joe, after you do your presentation, lynda.com has some really good training on Git and GitHub.
Is that true?
Yeah. And if you have a Multnomah County library account, you can create a free account to Lynda. And so after you do your training, you can tell people after you need more stuff.
That's a good idea. I didn't know about that.
Yeah, it's really good. So just, I mean, I don't know if you want to take the effort to go that route, but just might mention that.
It doesn't sound like too much effort.
It's really not too bad, yeah. And if you already have a Lynda account, then you're better. So.
Thank you.
It's really good. I like it a lot. There's like Git Essentials, GitHub Essentials, and I think there's others. I think there's 3 or 4 on there.
How long does it take to go through one?
About 3 hours.
Okay.
Yeah,
anyway, we can mention it right now since Glenn's mentioning it, but lynda.com with a Y, right?
Lynda.
If you have a Multnomah library card, you can create an account there and do some more Git workshops and stuff.
So Multnomah County has, I think you have to log in as a Multnomah County patron. Go into the Multnomah County website, and then, go into the Multnomah County website, and then say, go to lynda.com. And they give you free access if you have a library card. And then once you get into lynda.com, do a search for Git or GitHub, and there's a GitHub Essentials. It's a several hours, like 2-ish, 3-ish maybe.
You will need your library pin.
Yes, you need your library pin and all that stuff. But it's pretty good. So like after you guys do all your training and you want to go back, it's like, what the hell did they just say there? Although you're making a recording, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's even good too. But they've got some pretty good trainers on it. So it's a good resource.
Yes, we have like as many teaching people as we do learning people, which is good for everyone. Good. It's pretty fun.
What was the thing with commit? It's, could you go back one slide?
Yes.
Thanks, Glenn.
So it's almost as if commit, in my mind, commit updates the online repository. You request your credentials so it can know that you have permission to do this, and then it updates the changes.
No, maybe. That's what push does.
Oh.
Commit just, it's all, that's still all local. Only push and pull go up to the server.
Only push and pull go up to the server. Commit creates the history.
Mm-hmm.
and it allows you to push stuff. You can't
mm-hmm.
push until you commit.
Mm-hmm.
Because commit adds it to the big like ledger
mm-hmm.
of changes.
Yes, 100% correct from that point on. And then you push.
Okay.
And you don't need credentials to clone or pull from GitHub because it's all open source stuff.
Mm.
But sometimes it'll, if you have like a private server or whatever, then yes. Pushing, it'll ask you to log in if you haven't tried that already. Well, I'm.
What? So if you do have a like paid account, you get to use private?
On GitHub. There's other sites that'll host private repositories.
For free?
For free.
Oh, nice.
GitLab is one.
GitLab.
And they, I mean, they have a premium version as well that gives you other features.
Mm-hmm.
The thing with Git is it's like you only get a few private repositories unless
GitHub.
You... unless you like pay a subscription fee or something.
I thought you got no private repositories.
I just try to
you
create
one.
It didn't let me create one at all.
Oh really?
Yeah, I don't think
yeah,
you get any.
It's like,
you pay.
It's like he's like, yes, you create one. What's your credit card number? That's what I asked. I was like, okay.
I mean, it might have been they might have let you do private ones at first.
Yeah, previously they let you do like two private repositories.
I mean that would make sense.
That would account for.
GitLab is one. You can. I know Amazon Web Services can host Git for pretty cheap, and you can also run it on a home server or something. You know, whatever works for you.
If you were really old school.
Yeah. Yeah. Pulling. So pull just copies all the server stuff to your computer, basically, and it'll try and merge everything together at that time. Right?
Yes.
Because you used to have to do git fetch and then git merge. Pull is like a newer thing, but it's not really new anymore, but it came a little bit later on and it kind of does both of those at once.
That's a little bit of a can of worms, the difference between fetch and pull.
Right.
So fetch is kind of a lower level command than pull. So fetch gets all the stuff that's on the remote repository and just puts it into your history. So it doesn't actually put it, it doesn't unpack it into your current working folder. So it's all hidden in the .git folder. Pull fetches and then tries to attach that history to your current working folder.
So if you have changes in the file and you do a pull without committing or pushing those changes,
it
won't let you.
Right. It won't wipe it out. It'll just say, "Hey, I'm not gonna fast forward with this."
So then, how if you did something stupid with the file, you just won't have to deal with it?
There are two ways to do that. Well. At least two ways to do that. One of them is git reset --hard, which will just straight up delete all changes and take you back to the commit you were on when you started making changes.
Mm-hmm.
Git stash will take all of your changes and kind of bundle them into something that's like a commit, but not a commit. In that it's a stash. It's not part of the history, it's just some nebulous changes that can be applied. So you, if you...
Can
if
other
you
people see those nebulous changes?
I don't think so. There might be a way...
The stash?
I don't think you can push
the stash. Is local.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the kind of, it's just off to the side and you can bring it back if you want to recover those changes. I thought, but aren't you saying if you change a bunch of stuff on one file and you want to reset that one file,
yeah,
that you can also use a git checkout to just grab it from the server and drop it in for you.
Oh.
If you're just messing with something, you're just like, this is all crap, just give me whatever Joe was working on that file because he did it right. You just do git checkout on that one file and it'll just drop in the latest copy.
Wait, so what does git checkout do again?
It does a bunch of things, but that's one of the things is you're working on, Joe and I are doing something, I screw it up and I can't figure out how to like undo everything I did because I've been working on it for 6 hours, just give me what Joe has or give me what Joe did last night. Get checked out the file and it'll drop in the latest version from the server.
The latest version.
If that makes sense.
From the master.
Yeah, from the master on, or whatever branch you're on. Master is the default branch.
That's where my understanding stops.
Sorry, yes. I know that's, we're going to get to that. Sorry. I'm being a little pedantic. But you're right.
What would be like get checked out cherry picked, right?
I think actually yeah. Well, maybe. We can experiment with that. That's getting a little bit more advanced than we want to get. But we're just for the sake of discussion, there is a way to do that. And we can cover it in a few minutes if we have time.
Footnote. You guys are both using Linux, right?
I got a Mac. Oh.
You know about man pages?
Yeah.
Man git.
I think it works in git bash too, doesn't it?
I don't think so.
I just pulled up in, Ubuntu on Windows.
Okay.
Oh, that's, well, that's different.
So man and then whatever command gives you a little manual for how to use stuff.
Hmm.
And this also works for subcommands in Git.
Okay, but this is like, sometimes these things are a bit unapproachable.
They are.
Yeah.
So
they are a little unapproachable, but they are full of information at the same time. It's kind of, it's one of those trade-off things, but it's almost always there for like any command, and you're gonna find what you need. It just takes you a few minutes to get there. So it's kind of handy in that sense.
If you don't, there's always Stack Overflow.
Right.
Yes.
On a man page, assuming it's using less as your pager, you can do /, and then type something and hit enter, and it'll search for it.
Let's do that again. I was trying to read this thing. So,
/, and then a word.
Ah, I know. Okay, it's like Control F. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, that's
okay.
Basically what it is.
And then lowercase and capital N will like bring you to the next result of that search.
Lowercase and capital.
It's just man pages are great too for stuff Git, but also like grep, because these are like utilities that have just a wealth of options that are available, and so there's been so many times where I'll open it and just find the exact option I need because it's gonna, the man pages just cover everything, and yeah, it's unapproachable, but you're gonna get there. Like it's basically guaranteed that you're gonna find the information.
Isn't it like if I just learn to read the like command line syntax better, I'd be able to understand that because they'll give like really generic like formulas. You know, those are like something, you know, in brackets, option, in
so
brackets,
would
object,
you go to the top?
So, like, I feel like that sort of stuff, that's what I need to learn how to understand, right?
Yeah, there's a little bit of a syntax to it. So, like, the dash and a letter is supposed to be a flag,
mm-hmm.
and stuff in brackets is optional,
mm-hmm.
and stuff out of brackets would be not optional.
Mm-hmm.
I think some man pages specifically use that to be a positional argument. I don't know how they specify whether something's positional.
Sorry, which one's positional?
Like what the notation is for a positional argument. Yeah, I'd say just don't worry about it and copy the order they have there.
Yeah, but the options are going to be in there. Okay, and then your flags, you can always just concatenate them into one big mess, right?
Yes,
usually.
Anything not in brackets is a necessary operand.
Yes. But, like, you can't, it's, if you kind of interpret this, these two lines, like, dash E and dash F are not going to be able to go into your mess because it wants, it's saying that it wants those broken out if you're going to use them.
Mm. Okay.
And, yeah, it starts listing off all your options.
This is where I need to learn how to read those command pages.
Yeah, it takes a little bit of experience, but I think even like if you're doing command line stuff for like an hour and you use man pages the whole time, it's gonna start to build on itself pretty quickly.
For sure.
I mean, maybe not. I don't know, but I don't know like everyone's experience. I don't want to assume too much.
No, you're fine.
I've been, yeah.
The flags can go anywhere in your command.
No.
Depends on the command.
Maybe. Usually they go first.
They go first.
Or second. You do command options, then files or whatever you're gonna work with.
Like git commit dash m.
Git's a little bit weird because git space commit is kind of a, isn't it an alias kind of for git dash commit?
I think of it as like making its own little shell, which, you know, is totally not what it's doing, but it's kind of a nice
way. It's like its own scope sort of thing.
Yeah.
That does make more sense. It's a command within a command.
So even though there's a space in git commit, I just think of it as a single command.
Yeah.
In your head, you might want to make it look a little bit like that.
Okay.
And then, yeah. Even though you're actually doing that. Because, it gets just a little bit inconsistent. It's a weird special case.
Yeah, don't overthink it.
Right.
Yeah, except for some special characters that the shell looks at, like commands really just grab all of their arguments, and it's up to them how they interpret them, so they don't all have a consistent syntax.
Mm-hmm. That's why you gotta read the man page. Okay.
Are we ready to talk about pushing, I think
so.
So it's pretty, it'll happen pretty automatically, because all the weird stuff that could possibly happen when you're synchronizing is going to happen on your machine. The server does not deal with merging or anything. So that happens when you pull, basically. If there's anything weird happening, it'll happen when you pull. Then you get it fixed. You have to do it kind of manually. It's usually automatic, but yeah, it's happening here. And then when you push, everything's ready to be synchronized. If it's not, then it's not going to let you push, basically. If you make a bunch of commits and someone else does as well, it's going to give you an error when you try and push, because it's going to be like, it's going to say you have to do a pull and a merge before you're allowed to push.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something that makes sense?
Wait, so it's like your computer, the bricks. It's like your computer, right? And then you have your like data up here.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, say that you want to change the same file as like this guy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like the exact same file.
Mm-hmm.
How does it know which one to actually change?
It does a. So kind of we're getting to the point where we can start talking about that. And so that's going to basically go over it line by line. And it just it just kind of knows a lot of the time.
Yeah. That's kind of true.
It's kind of true. It tends to work out. It doesn't do it 100% of the time. And so when it doesn't work, which we're going to show in a minute, it'll just present the two options to you and you pick it yourself. So that's when it requires a little bit of brain power. It just happens less often than you might expect, especially if you're working in a team of like four or five. Because, you know, a lot of times it'll be divided up anyway and there won't be a conflict at all. But yeah, Git is, it's just been in development for so long, like some really smart people just kind of figured it out.
So like the typical scenario is that one of you will have committed your changes first,
mm-hmm.
and say it's the other person. When you try to push, Git will yell at you and say that you can't push because you have you don't have the full history that the remote has. So it'll tell you you need to pull first. So you do Git pull, and you get the history from the remote. And if there are conflicts, most of the time, it'll resolve them for you automatically. And it'll just bring up a commit for you that already has the message that says merge such and such with such and such. And you can just say, okay, save that, because that's
a totally descriptive message of what we're doing, and then you push it. In the rarer case, it wouldn't know how to automatically merge them, and you'd have to help it.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll get to that.
Okay. But the whole idea is that if everybody get pulled before they push, then the most recent changes are the ones acted upon by your push.
Yes.
Good, sir. Right.
That sounds correct.
I could go either way on it. It sounds slightly more correct than incorrect. That's fine. If it's not, we'll have another chance to sort it out here.
Has an expectation value of 0.7 correct.
0.7
correct. So ultimately, you either need to be on clean master, or if you're not on a clean master, you're going to need to merge.
More or less. The stuff we're talking about is true for any branch.
Mm-hmm.
So I think branches is what we're about to do. But you could be on, dev_Bert,
mm-hmm.
and nobody's going to be committing changes other than you to that.
Right.
And so you're not really going to have to deal with merging until you want to bring it back into master.
Mm-hmm.
So what's with the master dev_Bert? What's with that? What are those?
I think that's...
Is that a branch? Basically?
That's like the two slides from now, right?
Yes.
I think...
Just wait two slides.
Yeah.
I think we can basically go on. I want to do this. Which one is the one that's probably going to be worked on the most since I left? It's going to be DevSet, that's right. It's going to be DevSet.
Could you go back to that slide real quick?
Yeah.
I've got that.
So I was gonna. What?
I think.
What?
What? Mark wanted to see a slide.
Just
which
the
slide?
Last slide, real quick.
That one?
So you update master branch of remote with your new branch.
Yes.
Cool, thank you.
So John uses this all the time.
Yeah, feel free to chime in if you have opinions. We're just here to make sure everyone's well learned on the subject. So I'm going to do this. I just want to see if this gets weird for fun.
I'm realizing there are no capstones here. Oh well.
They were the ones who were supposed to be.
That was the intention of this, right?
It was. It's fine.
We're going to be honorary capstone students.
Right.
Cool.
You just walk up to them. This is our capstone now.
Alright, so I'm pulling a ton of stuff because I haven't pulled in like a month. And it all went very smoothly, which is too bad. Yep, that was too smooth. That's not what I was going for. I think we can do. So, we did get status a couple of times. You guys should know about that, and it basically gives you the whole status. If you've been following along so far, you should be able to interpret what it's telling you for the most part, but feel free to ask. It's handy to run against status kind of whenever you're doing something, but once you have a good feel of where you are, you can just kind of run stuff as you go. What was the git log tree? Dash tree?
Git log dash graph.
Dash graph. This one has
Dash dash graph.
So we're about to talk about branches and that sort of thing, but if you do the git log, it shows you the whole history of all the commits that have been made and timestamps and IDs of those commits.
What's git log?
That's git log.
Git log.
and then I did it with the dash dash graph option.
It's like a visualization.
It gives a slight visualization because you can see how this these commits here got, or that commit there in particular got branched. This red line is kind of the master, so commit, commit, commit. And then this guy was on his own branch. He's off to the side. And then it got merged in down here, it looks like. Is that right? Am I interpreting that right?
I think time goes up.
Oh, time goes up.
Yeah.
So we branched out here. Oh, yeah, because that says merge branch. So same idea, except it's going up, not down.
So you cloned. Clone is completely different than splitting from master.
Yes. Clone is just to get started, basically.
Okay, so what did the person do to make that branch?
We're going to talk about that in 3 seconds.
Okay.
I just want you to know that branches exist and that you can visualize them this way. And then you can merge them back together later.
And that's so that you just don't break stuff that you know works, right?
Kind of. That's one use.
It's just you have your
version control, basically, is.
We'll find out on the next one. Everyone's been very. This is the moment. We're finally here. We've been waiting for branches all day. So to create a branch, just like you asked, you can do git branch dev to make a new branch. And what do you call head? Is that like a variable or what? Put a location.
Head is. The name of like the current state. There's some name for it that I'm forgetting, but I keep calling it like working directory. That's wrong
That's
name for it, but
yeah.
Close enough.
It's the alias for like the last commit. Yeah.
Yes, alias is good.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So it'll move your head from, if your head's on master, you're just gonna, every commit you make is gonna go on there and extend that. Creating a new branch will move your head up to the other branch, and all of your commits are going to go follow that.
It's the place of your last commit.
Yes. The commit that describes the current state of everything. So
you can technically, I think you can roll your head back
yes,
to here. And
that's,
so
that's what happens when you check out an older commit, is it just puts head back there. So if you were looking at the like git log output, and it's got, can you bring that up a sec? So it's got all these crazy numbers. These are the hashes that refer to these particular commits. So if we did git checkout and then like a few of these numbers and letters, just enough for to uniquely identify it, that would bring head down to this commit.
That's git checkout and then portion of the hash.
So head can be on any commit and on any branch. It's just telling you what history you have checked out right now.
What's your location on the ground?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And that can be like forward and backward in time is the other. You don't have to worry about why or when you would do that. That can come a little later, but just know that that's a possibility
right
at this point. And then git branch dash A gives you a listing. You can also do git checkout dash B to create a branch. No, that's how you switch branches, but you can also create a new one that way, because I just did it.
Huh.
Git checkout moves you branches. If you use a dash B, it'll create a new branch.
You git checkout master, git checkout dev. But you can do git checkout dev, and then some portion of the hash that you find from the log,
if
you could be more versatile in your movement as opposed to just the latest commit.
So if you wanted to go to a particular commit on dev, you would just give it the hash for that commit. Yeah, because doing git checkout dev is basically a shortcut for saying take me to the latest commit that's on dev.
So it's like maybe an alias for the last hash.
Yeah.
Or something like that.
These are all the branches that are on the DevSet repo. I was working off Semtech because I was working on that, what do you call it, 70 centimeter radio. But I can switch over to, like, I think Miles was working on CAN. So once I run this git checkout CAN, it'll even autofill. You know about tab to autofill, right? So now, yeah, it basically copies everything, or it takes all those files and shows everything on the branch. So that's kind of what you were talking about, is where there's like these files that have all the commits in them, and you can see how that's in there. And then it also has like versions of every file. So yes, that exists once again, but we don't care. We just run our git commands, and git handles everything in the background for us. So it basically took all those files that Miles has been working on and makes my whole directory look like how it does for him.
For Miles.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
Or whoever's working on this branch. I'm just using Miles because I know he worked on this branch, but yes.
So it changes the directory in your system to match Miles' most recent command.
Mm-hmm. Even if we were working on the same file for our different purposes, now all my stuff is the same as his, and I can update it as needed and do my own commands. And then I can switch back when I'm ready to continue with what I was doing before.
So merging is basically how you take work that people have been doing on different branches and bring it together so you can actually use each other's work. So the command for it is git merge, and then the name of the thing you want to merge with. So wherever your head is, you're going to create a commit after that head that's going to include the changes from head and whatever commit you specified. So if you had a dev branch and a master branch, and you wanted to merge those two. If you wanted to merge the changes from dev into master, you would check out the master branch, so git check out master. And then you'd do git merge dev to merge in the latest commit on the dev branch. And if it's something that's easy to merge, if git can figure out how to merge it, it'll just do it. And it'll bring up your text editor saying merge between such and such and such and such, and you'll just say okay, that's a perfectly acceptable commit or perfectly acceptable merge message.
And you can kind of imagine how branches are nice for working on things in parallel, because we've talked about how, like, well, if we're all working on our Git repository and we want to pull and push things, and, you know, how do conflicts get resolved? Well, magically, and also you sometimes have to do it yourself, and that's all true. But when you branch off, everyone can do their own thing, and then you only have to worry about those conflicts once in a while, or whenever you feel like you're ready to do it. So it's kind of nice, especially if there's like a feature or something, or yeah, something you want to work on in a project, and you're not sure if it's actually going to go anywhere. Like, you can create a branch for that, and then if it turns into a dead end, it doesn't matter, because you're not, like, affecting anything. And then if it happens that you want it to be merged into the main project, you can make that happen pretty easily as well. And you can also do it on the fly. You can get things synchronized. We usually don't run into it too much on PSAS, I don't think, because we're usually working in small groups of, like, five. So it's almost okay sometimes to all be working on the master. I don't quite recommend it, but we can get away with it just because it's so few people and you can communicate in person. And then, you know, for some of the more busy stuff, we'll branch out more, like the DevSat repo you saw had a bunch of branches.
It's like their project.
You
kind of give it to them.
Yeah. If you're working with, like, several dozen people on one thing, then you definitely don't want to make full use of branches. But if you just have a few branches, you can always keep them running and, like, synchronize them on the fly and merge in certain things that you need. All I guess I'm saying is that when you merge a branch, it doesn't always mean that it is
eliminate.
Done.
It doesn't eliminate the branch.
Because you can merge it and then they can both still keep going, and you merge again as needed in whatever direction is helpful.
So you have to switch to the master to merge that?
Not. When you merge, you're doing whatever you're doing,
mm-hmm.
whatever branch you're on or anything, and you're saying, I want this branch to come to where I am.
Yeah.
So it doesn't. It might be master, it might not be.
Okay, but you can't merge the branch you're on.
You go to where
yeah.
you want. Yeah.
You're pulling
switch.
To you.
Yeah, you're pulling
yes.
to you. Yes.
Yeah.
And that's what, yeah, that always confuses me too, and I go and look it up and make sure. But yeah, you're pulling to you.
Mm-hmm.
Not.
Yeah. So if you want to merge the dev into you, you go to the master and bring it to you.
You go to wherever you want it to be.
So
you bring it to you.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a conflict ready?
I do.
Oh, good. So this is also what we've been talking about is when we run into these merge conflicts that can't be automatically resolved, and what that looks like. We kind of know, we can all imagine in our minds how to create a conflict ready, how that would look. This was your slide. Can you parse that for me?
I mean, I'm basically just going to read off the slide. I think.
That's fine.
So, you know, say we're both working on the same line of the same file, and we make different changes there. Like, say, I do a while loop and Evan does a for loop and they're happening on the same line. Git won't know what to do with that. If we made changes, like if I made changes on line 10 and Evan made changes on line 100, Git would just put those changes in there
mm-hmm.
and be fine with it. But if they're happening on the same line, it's gonna say, I don't know how to merge this. Does that correspond to what's happening on here? so, like, you'll one way to make these conflicts happen is with polls. So I think this is basically what we described earlier, right? Where somebody made changes, pushed it to the repo. Somebody else made changes in the same location on the same file, tried to push it, Git yelled at them, and so they polled, and then they had to conduct a merge. Let's go to the next slide.
Oh yeah, because you did it all manually. Did you ever set up that merge tool?
Meld? I installed it, but I still don't use it.
I'm just impressed that you're able to do this. Anyway, it just looks so confusing.
So let's see if I can remember what I did with this. So I'm on some branch and I'm trying to merge with a different branch. So I think in this example I'm on like master or something.
You're on branch merge example.
Oh, I'm on merge example.
And
I'm getting from.
And Git's giving him an error that he has an unmerged path.
So in both of those histories, there are modifications to extra.txt.
Can you go back, please?
Yes.
Okay, so you said git status, but it's throwing an error even though you're not trying to merge. Oh, you merged before, and it's a conflict.
Yeah, so auto merged some stuff, it looks like.
Will it? Okay.
But then it failed. It failed the automatic merge. So it's telling, it basically just tells you what it wants you to do is just fix it, figure out which one's which, and then do another commit to once you have it prepared.
So the more typical way to do this is you just open the file in your text editor and you'd scroll to where you see lines that look like this, with all the equal signs and greater than or less than symbols. Those lines are Git trying to highlight for you where the different changes are occurring. And so I think it's my changes, their changes, right? So after the less than signs and head, and before the equal signs, these are the changes that were on the merge example branch. And these are the conflicting changes on the dev example branch. So all Git wants me to do is go in and figure out which of these lines to keep, and then just delete these highlighting lines. So I open up my text editor, and I choose which lines to keep and which lines to throw out. And Cat is just spitting out what's in the file so we can see what's in there. Which lines did I end up keeping?
This one. Oops.
Like all of them, basically.
I think you kept all of them, yeah.
Yeah. So, for example, if you wanted to keep this line and throw out this line, you'd just make that change in your text editor.
We have an example to set up, so
yeah,
we can show you that in a minute. It's all of it.
So you need to add the changes to that file after you've fixed the merge. One thing that's happened to me a few times is I'll like go make the changes in the editor and then try and commit it, and Git will yell at you because it still thinks it's a both modified file. So you have to add it and it'll say, okay, it's new stuff, let's stage commit. So if before doing git add extra, I did git status, it would look the same as it did before with the both modified message. But from here, it's basically just a regular commit. You add the file that has the fixes.
It's plugged into the computer.
I started recording before plugging it in, and that seems to have worked. That'd probably be difficult to do anyways.
How about?
Maybe not that difficult. Do we want to show a demo of a conflict?
I think so. Let me see the next slide real quick. Yes, we do want to show that. Take that. Why is this full screen?
So these are all the different branches I have. Do I want to mention tags? Tags let you refer to individual commits without using their hash, by instead using a short name. And you can, look at man git tag if you want to know the commands for setting up tags. If you're on Windows, I guess this is a useful aside, you can just Google man pages for such and such command, and you'll get the same information. It's just a little less convenient.
What's your email?
Bdechant, so Bdechant.
Are you setting up the slides?
Yeah.
Could I throw my email in there as well?
Of course.
Yeah, me too.
a PDX?
Where do I want to?
I feel the Linda thing that you're talking about.
I might do that. That's one about it.
After the library.
Huh?
After the library, you can get the new
I
pen.
I know, to get my library card.
Musilmark 25.
That works, yeah.
EMT3 PDX. And shares.
Got it.
I should probably how do I zoom? Is that text big enough to see, or does that need to be bigger? Probably bigger.
I can see it, but I'm sitting
right. Shoot, I'm not used to this terminal. Oops. Oh well.
Is that your
okay. What does that
what?
Mean?
Is that your
is
that means I don't
yeah.
remember
yeah.
how to.
Oh, okay. So is that your
get bigger text
in
the
yeah,
access
the
terminal?
Both those encoder wheels are wrong.
I don't think you.
Okay.
So you're
just printed
the
wrong one.
Okay.
What?
You printed the wrong one.
Yeah. Sorry about that. I don't know if I uploaded it correctly. If anyone has SolidWorks, I can double check to make sure I can repush it later tonight.
That'd be great. I'll let my people know.
Can I actually just give you?
Let's see. Oh, wow.
If you can look up.
Are you kidding, Albert?
Peter Dill.
Yeah.
In that
I do
case,
like this quality,
I want to mention you probably already know the ways in which Git sucks for SolidWorks.
Yes, because it doesn't understand SolidWorks.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which means like all the wonderful stuff with branching does
uh-huh.
not, and merging
right.
doesn't really apply.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So just pull
yeah.
push basically, and that's all you can kind of do with SolidWorks.
Yeah, and then argue and bicker.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, you can sort of skirt around the fact that all SolidWorks files count as binary from the perspective of Git by using assemblies with lots of tiny parts rather than
you
like
just
doing everything in one monolithic assembly. Like if you have, for example, the Orisat top level assembly. Is constructed
yeah.
of other smaller assemblies.
Yeah, parts.
Which,
we've all read the repo,
well,
right?
Not just of other smaller parts, but other smaller assemblies.
I
so
mean,
it's assemblies within assemblies.
Cool. And then I saw my
so you can make a change in
yeah.
just one of the assemblies and only commit the changes for that assembly without touching everything in the dang assembly.
But then you don't have to go and update.
Yeah, so if you actually like pay attention to the changes you're making and just make sure to rebuild when you start working and then reset after you stop working, then it kind of works.
You guys can have fun with that.
Yeah.
It's not hard for the rest of us, EC and CS people.
Well, I know that SolidWorks is working some sort of cloud feature too.
They want you to pay.
Yeah, it's an add-on. And it sucks.
Yeah. It sucks.
Yeah. So do you not have a merge for us?
No, I do.
Oh, you do? Or a conflict in it?
So it's yelling at me that I have a conflict that it doesn't know how to resolve on its own. See, Albert?
It's okay.
So if I do Git status, it'll tell me that on both of my branches I've made modifications to extra.txt. So if I'm still doing good. So all this stuff up here, these are the changes that I had originally made, or this is what my file looked like before I tried to merge. And then these are the changes in the branch that I'm trying to merge with.
And those will be dispersed throughout the file wherever
yeah.
there's a conflict. So this one's a little, it's just mildly confusing because the whole file is a conflict because it's an example. But if things are the same, it'll just show you, you'll be able to skip right past the parts that are the same, and then you'll see like chunks that are like this.
Yeah, so what I would recommend is if it's a reasonably sized file, one that is not trivially small like this one, I would actually search for this string. So if you, control F or whatever the search is for your text editor, for just a crap ton of less than signs, that'll take you to, because, in any reasonable file, you're not going to have one and two less than signs next to each other, probably. Maybe three. Certainly not seven.
Right. Can you try it with the merge tool before you do this?
Oh, with meld?
Yeah, I think it's just get merge tool. One word.
Yeah. With a dash?
Nope.
Like that?
Yep. Yep. Is it not? There it is.
Oh. That's nice.
Except your text is gray.
Yeah. The color theme is a little bonkers. But I think if I highlight it, we can actually make it readable.
Oh, wow. That's not easy to read.
Well,
so
on a sane color scheme, it might make sense.
Oh, there. That's better. Whatever you did.
I don't think it did anything, but okay.
Well, it's darker than it was, isn't it? I thought it was brighter. Anyway, so this is you can install a different tools. This one's called Meld. And apparently Joe doesn't use it, even though I showed him that it exists. But it graphically displays, so on the left is the head version, on the right is the server version, and then it'll highlight like additions in green and conflicts in red and stuff, and you can basically go down and merge everything to that center column, and that'll be your final output.
I forget how to use this thing.
So the left-hand side is your head.
Yeah.
Right hand side is the server.
Great. And then you put them, you just click which version you want to put into the center one. And that'll be your final version.
But don't you, isn't that like a specific use case? Shouldn't the right hand side be, whatever, like the other branch?
Yes, that's what it is.
But in this example, it's the master.
Yes.
Actually, I think in this example, neither branch is master.
Oh.
One of the branches is like merge example, and one of them is merge example two.
Apparently. So this, anyway, it's whatever you're conflicting with, and it, to an extent, it doesn't matter specifically what they are. You just want that center one to look like what you want it to look like.
Mm-hmm.
As
yeah.
you go down.
It's like a detail, right?
Yeah, kind of. But like, yeah. And you'll be able to tell too. You'll be like, oh, I wrote that. I didn't write this. But
mm-hmm.
whichever one, you just need to make sure that everything gets in there that needs to be in there for your code or whatever it is to be functional. Yeah. So this is, I don't know. You can do it in the, you can do it in Vim or whatever, kind of like how Joe was showing it, where you remove the head side, the signs, and the
mm-hmm.
tail bit, and make it look correct in there. Or this one that gives a nice visual. Do you mind if I plug in for a sec?
Okay, sure.
I'm going to show you, let me show you a screenshot real quick of a more, this is just from their page. So it kind of looks more like that if you have a bunch of different conflicts that you're trying to bring together.
Hmm.
And it was originally made just for like two files that you're trying to bring together, which is why you sometimes see it with only two columns, but three things.
It's the same thing.
Yeah.
It's just in the two file, maybe it's like the left is your final.
Right.
Or whatever.
Right. And so if you have this, you just make the center one look correct, and here's two versions of the file that may or may not be correct.
That's great.
Yeah.
Why not, you guys?
So that's easy enough to install.
This is great.
Right. There's one other thing. Did you have anything else?
I don't think so.
There's one other thing I'd like to show just for fun, because I think it's interesting.
I guess we.
Oh, you unplug it? Well, the show's over, I guess. It's Mark. Mark's done, so all of us are done. They will be. That's why they're here, is because we're secretly trying to recruit them, like we bring. But that's the only reason we bring people here.
Just to.
They'd both be really helpful, but we just need, we need to get the real convincing people here, like Andrew or whoever.
Yeah. So let's see the slides. What slide would number?
Where do you guys write?
I do radio systems. Like,
where is it?
It's like, we basically work for PGE, sort of.
Oh,
not
cool.
Really.
Yeah, Berlin General Electric radio system, and so we're working on that part.
Yeah.
That's cool. So are you an analog engineer?
Kind of Glenn-ish.
Or kind of software developer.
Where's the thing? Oh, there's the thing.
I'm in this makeup program, and they like talk to all the companies, and that was like the only thing I'm interested in with PGE, for setting up like optic, like fiber optic network, and also like the remote. It's like from the distribution center to like another station, right? This little two-way radio thing. Yeah.
That's like. That's different than what we're doing, but kind of.
Cool.
That's the fiber optic stuff would be on your network.
Was it, do you think that's for like MPLS stuff? What he's talking about?
Yeah, if you got,
that's
if
funny.
You got the wire network side. Mm-hmm. So there's another project that's going on that they're going to upgrade that system. And there's a whole other crew working that. We're working in the same facility though. Facility, so I'm doing the testing.
Are you applying for MeCup now?
I'm in the program, and like the selection is in January.
Oh, nice.
To, like, actually get the company. Yeah, we had like the big fall event last month. Like meet and greet everyone.
Right.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
it's a whole
part of that.
Process.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. They're like the first ones I talked to, and I was so it's like multiplexed LS or whatever I don't know what it stands for, but that's like.
Well, maybe he'll. You might be in our office.
Yeah, it would be our group.
Point.
The group that we're working on.
That's funny.
That's cool. Yeah. Interesting stuff. Anyways, thanks you guys.
Yeah, mm-hmm. See you around. So I got bored once and I found this cool article about like Git branching methodologies. And that's like impossible to read. And I wish, I don't know if I can make it bigger.
I mean, you could also just go into presentation mode. Right?
I don't know if that would make it that much bigger. And it's also going to pop up on my screen, but I can do that. There it is. That did help. But they kind of divide up their branches that way, and it's way overcomplicated for PSAS stuff, but it gives you an idea of like what's possible.
Master's on the right.
Right. And so they have a branch for like hot fixes only. And then release branches, development, and feature branches. And so if you see, if you can see those blurbs, it kind of talks about how they merge together. And I don't know if you guys do anything this complicated.
I water it down a lot. So we do a very basic feature branch workflow.
Yeah.
So some of the developers try to do like Git flow.
Is that what this is?
This is trying to model a Git flow.
Okay.
Git flow is just a lot of conventions, which a lot of people have decided that it worked well.
I just kind of remember what it was called.
Kind of put that forward, and everybody kind of adopted it. But you have Git flow, which has tooling around it also, so you can install tooling that will kind of take care of a lot of it for you. But it's overcomplicated for almost everybody.
Yeah, definitely.
So if you look at GitHub, they have something documented called GitHub flow. You use GitLab, they have the adaptation of that called GitLab flow.
Huh.
In GitHub, you have a lot more kind of social collaboration that you will fork repositories and pull requests. In GitLab, you might all be working in the same repository and you work requests. So thing that I just enforce at our work and in the repositories that we work in is that you never push to master. You always branch off to master. We will often have a develop branch, so we'll have master develop. Those are two long-lived branches. So when you create a new branch, you would branch off of develop into your, like it could be a feature, it could be a fix. We don't really care how you're doing it or what you're doing. Just when it's ready, you rebase all the develop changes into your branch and then merge request into develop. And then when it's a release, you actually release from master.
Would master for you guys be like synonymous with release, or if it's on there, it's going to get pushed out?
So the way I handle it is, so production gets deployed off the last tag in master. Staging gets deployed off the head of master. And the development environment just gets deployed off of whatever's the head of development. But you can define it however you want. And it depends on your group and what you're doing, whether that makes sense. That makes sense in our environment.
Have CI set up?
Yep.
Does that run on the develop branch or the feature branches?
We use GitLab locally, and you can define it any way you want. And I define it exactly like I just described it, so that in the production system, you have to do a merge request, which has like approval processes that like it's not going to merge unless like it's been pre-rebased and can't do a fast forward merge from develop to master, and it's not going to deploy to production unless there's a tag. Otherwise, it's just going to redeploy the last tag. So if you didn't tag your release, then it's not going to work. So it kind of enforces those workflows and those practices. And there are definitely repositories that we have that don't have any of that set up. It's just like one guy committing to master all the time. And we don't necessarily like that, but that's not everything is perfect.
Right. We can relate to that on our end too. There's always someone who's
the majority
who's like
of CSS repositories are one person just pushing the master.
And if you haven't seen GitLab, it's like having, you can run it locally. You don't have to use like the GitLab.com service, but it's pretty similar to GitHub, and it's got a pretty good CI built in. It's sort of modeled after Travis CI, which you would often use with GitHub. But that means all your CI config lives in the repository with your code. If you're using Jenkins, which is probably one of the other most common CI tools, your CI configuration is separate from your code repository, which sometimes can be more flexible and sometimes a bit more.
I did want to show, since we use GitHub a lot, what like a real GitHub repository kind of looks like, because this one's for the Signal Messenger for Android, but you can see kind of graphs of what people have contributed, and that never shows up because it's too many forks. But it also shows branches, which is kind of neat to look at, but it's not going to show up. There's a whole issue system that I think we're trying to use. Did that ever catch on?
For varying degrees. It would be nice if people used it more, but...
You post a lot of issues, I believe.
Yeah,
it's classic PSAS where some people jump on and start doing it and nobody else cares.
I mean, when you've got repos, when there's only like one or two people working on them, then it's kind of shouting into the void. But I think it's really nice to have on there, because then the documentation of what has happened lives with the other documentation.
Right. Because we're always going in circles about documentation and communication, at least for the last 8 months, or even 12 months now. When did we switch to Basecamp the first time? That was probably a year ago, right?
Yeah, I think it was about a year ago.
And we're still, it's still not quite settled. Is it? Or is it?
I mean, I think it's settled that we're not using Basecamp.
Well, yeah. So there's issues. And then pull requests, kind of like what John was saying, it's the same as a merge request. But if you do want to contribute to like a GitHub project, you can make some changes, or you clone, make some changes, and then you can set up a pull request like these people did here. And they're requesting that the administer, because you know you don't have permission to just push to whatever GitHub you want to, because not everybody can do that. But you can set up a pull request and request that the main developers who do have that permission pull your code in. So for instance, this guy wanted to be able to copy messages with readable formatting, so he clones the project, implements the feature, and then they have a whole discussion here about it. And I know this guy's the main developer for this project, and so he's providing suggestions, and then they might eventually decide to merge your feature into their open source project. We can pull open commits, and we can see what the changes actually were. So added that, removed, added. So it's kind of nice to be able to look through all that. And it's not something I was super familiar with until later. So I'm just showing it now. It's not like important. It's just nice to know that it's out there. Are we good?
I
think we covered everything that we try and usually cover. So congratulations, you're partially somewhat up to speed, maybe. Hopefully.
Don't forget to like obsessively check the man pages. People online sometimes gripe if someone has not read the entire man page for something, but honestly, that's not how you're supposed to use them. Like, you're supposed to bring them up for 10 seconds and find the command that you forgot.
I'm still just not learning it, but I'll definitely try learning a little bit of library today and pick up my card. So. Library cards. I've had one of those for a while.
Rosa's, Joe and I are happy to help. Jamie is also super good with this stuff. Like, if you, I've definitely gotten myself into a couple of Git holes and corners. And Jamie, what do? He's like, all right, let's figure this out. Because yeah, it can be, the simple stuff is simple, but if it starts getting complicated, it can get really complicated quickly. And there's usually a command that'll dig you out, or a series of commands. So figuring out how that's going to work is.
The nice thing, though, is that like because it's a tool that stores the history, there's almost always a way to undo your mistakes. There's another relevant XKCD. Right?
There usually is.
Well, this is 2 of 2, right? Why can't I mirror the displays?
What is that?
This is our 70-centimeter antenna.
70-centimeter.
Yeah. So this is exciting as well.
To
radio people, it's mildly
terrible
because it's going to space, right?
Yeah.
So that's on the satellite. It's going to have these, you can barely see the wires, but it's like a turnstile antenna.
Uh-huh.
So that's for the, that's going to be the little radio that I worked on.
Okay.
For like system control. As opposed to like the flight computer.
They did that as a comic, but I think that's how everyone starts.
Yeah.
If it's screwed up, I'm going to delete it and then just start over.
The first two or three times you do this, there's no shame.
Yep.
After that, it is a little bit shameful. But the surprising thing is it works for the most part. Although for some of the repositories, it's kind of an awful way to do it. Because GitHub will start throttling you a little bit. So for the,
when does it do that?
For really big repos that have hundreds of SolidWorks files that have been changed.